Ladies and gentlemen, celebrating 5 years as a podcaster, introducing Nate the Great! Whoa!
The darkness, you know who go the hardest. I roll out the red carpet. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another edition of the Game Changer Podcast. I am Nate the Effing Great, and I am very, very happy, very excited because we have a little bit of a return happening here, ladies and gentlemen. She has been on the show for many years. Now she's residing in California, which I'm hearing is the fact that they have more than one lockdown going on. Let's face it, it's crazy. She is honestly one of the best cosplayers, one of my closest friends, somebody who I have definitely been very happy to call a friend. Bottom line, she's the one, the only, the fabulous Victory Bell, but you know her better as Tori, ladies and gentlemen.
Hi, yes, that was quite an introduction, but happy to be back and happy to be talking about what we're going to be talking about.
Yeah, I think the last time I actually had you on the show was when I was trying to bash a little bit of Marvel was better, but you stopped me and just saying, yeah, you forgot about this. It's like, oh yeah, that's right. Marvel did have rough things. And then we talked about Thor and it's like, at least he got better from 1 and 2.
Yeah, exactly. Everybody's getting better. So that means progress and we like progress.
Yeah, which is probably more we can say about what we're going to be talking about today. Ladies and gentlemen, we figure that since we are a couple of movie buffs, it's only fair that we talk a little bit about movies, one of which we were both really excited about. And honestly, it's going to be interesting to hear our opinions on this because the fact is that before we recorded, I definitely have heard a little bit of how she feels about the movie being, you know, in the realm that she is at and being a movie buff, hearing my side of it as well. We're going to be talking first about Wonder Woman 84. Honestly, guys, this was a movie that had major hype. It got released on HBO Max, which, in all honesty, is kind of nice that they did that because it definitely does keep the whole social distancing deal being as well as it is. But it also is just one of those things where it's like, nice, we get to see a movie. It's at home. It's going to be awesome. Does this movie live up to the hype? That is what we're going to be answering with this. So I will say this, that as it started out, we actually had a young Diana Prince basically doing a little bit of this Amazon competition, which in all honesty, I was not expecting them to start off like this. But anytime they show kind of her past and kind of what the struggle she had to go through, I like that because it does humanize her a little bit, even though she's basically almost considered a god at this point. But I don't know. What did you think of at least of the opening that we had?
I mean, I enjoyed the opening when it was happening, too. And you're like, okay, what's this going to lead to? I liked it. I liked the lesson that they're trying to teach. I also was thinking maybe, like, movie-wise, oh, did all these people have to be in the second movie, too? Did they have a contract or something?
Did they really need to, or were they just kind of paid extras on the whole deal? I think the jury's out on that. But in all honesty, it's kind of nice to see, you know, again, the fact that she's not the only one. So she doesn't have to have that kind of feeling of like, well, I'm the only one, so I can't battle this. No, she's got people that have literally been, you know, probably dealing with the same kind of battles that she had. And ultimately, is kind of one of those things where, again, it makes her feel a little bit more human. It's really kind of nice to see that. But we fast forward to 1984. How they keep deciding to go into, like, the 70s, the 80s, whether it is Marvel or DC, I'm not complaining about it. At the same time, it's kind of interesting seeing them kind of go back a little bit. It's like, it didn't really happen that long ago. I mean, it wasn't like Bridgerton, which is a series we'll probably discuss in a later show, where it happened like such classic times where, you know, they had the fancy dresses and the classic talk and just everything is all that kind of deal. Just kind of interesting, kind of looking back and seeing, well, even like 20, 30 years ago, seeing how far we've kind of, you know, evolved since then. It is kind of interesting when you look back at it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, now it's like 50 years ago almost, man.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, no, 40. I'm sorry. 40. but still, that's insane to me. And the title itself is, I don't know if we wanted to profess anything of like being like, oh, I'm not a big fan of the movie and you are a big fan of the movie or whatever you are.
I feel like as time goes on, we're going to definitely have that revealed. So,
because spoilers, I'm definitely. And so I'm like, one of my biggest things is like, I don't understand why it's 1984. Like, what? Like, I don't understand why. I don't understand what caused them to pick this setting. It seems extremely random and unnecessary.
I can see that point. I guess it's just, again, like another one of those situations where, you know, these times were better times. Remember when we had these times? Like, yeah. And we like to kind of move on, do this thing called move on from those times. Even though you have good intentions, we don't have to harp on that too much. I mean, that's why we also have...
Well, there's problems that come from the fact that it's going to be in 1984. Just because it's a prequel sequel, it causes a lot of issues within the DC universe, continuity wise. So that's the reason why I complain about it being in 1984. Because in 2018 or 2020, she's about to, you know, be back in the real world with Batman and Superman and tell us all these stories that aren't true because of 1984.
Yeah, it's really interesting to think about that. And I will say this, that I do appreciate the fact that they are at least trying to be very detailed when it comes to, you know, the fact that it is 1984. You definitely look back at the fashion, especially just seeing how we've kind of grown since then. And this is not a major spoiler because it's literally in the trailer, seeing all the outfits that Steve Trevor has to put on to kind of fit in to the time that he's in right now. It's really one of those things like, wow, this is, we had this kind of deal. He talks about the parachute pants, I believe it was, where it had like 20 different pockets in it or something like that. So it's like, wow, we evolved from that to just having like maybe 4 or 5 pockets if we're lucky.
Yeah. That was a cute scene, but again, things.
Yeah, right. Right. And actually, let's talk about that really quick, because this is where one of the issues I had with the movie was. So seeing Steve Trevor in the movie the first time around and the original, it had a purpose to it. It was one of those things where obviously he's introducing Diana to the new world. He's kind of like a guide to her. She's doing that kind of deal. In this one, it's one of those things where I feel like it's kind of the roles are switched, but it kind of drags too long with certain scenes.
Yeah, there's no reason to have brought back Steve Trevor. I think they're trying to humanize Wonder Woman even more and be like, teach the lesson of letting go of somebody. Like, they have passed. You have to let them go so that you can move on and live your own life, which Wonder Woman technically wasn't. But the beginning, like, there's just so many different lessons they're trying to throw at us with this movie that it's sometimes hard to grasp one at a time. And you're like, okay, because at the beginning, that whole scene was to be like, cheating doesn't prosper. Like, she doesn't get to win because she cheated. And we'll go into the fact that people are wishing, and I guess we're going to connect that and correlate that with cheating. I can play that game, but I also, like, cheating is something that really can happen and everybody wants the easiest route, where the wish thing is just kind of very fantastical and magical where you can't really explain much about it. And magic will be on DC's side for most of the movie because I can't explain it, so magic.
And I think what, the more you talked about it, the more it kind of actually connected a little bit with me. Maybe it was not necessarily the whole cheating aspect of it, but it is, you know, again, finding that easier route instead of just, you know, accepting reality. It's easier to just wish for it and have it kind of be something that can be fantasized about. And you're right. That is one of the things that during this movie, it is like the main focus on, because apparently Diana works at the Smithsonian. You know what? I'm actually kind of okay with it. It's one of the few times where it's like, hey, we actually get to see the Smithsonian other than, you know, Night at the Museum, because my God, that place does not get as much, you know, recognition as it does. Oh wait, I think they actually also had it in a Transformers movie, but other than that, I don't think the Smithsonian has really been focused on that much, unless it's like a documentary or like a special feature on TV.
Yeah, no, the Smithsonian is really cool. Never been. I want to. But again, I'm laughing because, like, so apparently she's worked at the Smithsonian then since at least 1984 is when we saw her pop up there, till 2018 or 2019 or whenever the Justice League was, she was still working there. But she looks totally the same. Don't worry about it. Don't complain about it. It's magic.
It's movie magic. We don't question these things. We just watch it.
Submit to the cause. Submit to the cause.
Oh my
gosh. Wonder Woman. You know I'm a Wonder Woman fan too. Oh, yeah. And you know what's funny? Every time, because I've had to speak about this on a Twitch live stream too. Every time I'm talking Wonder Woman, I'm having like a Beauty and the Beast mug with me. I'm like, don't you have Wonder Woman stuff? And I'm like, I know. I'm not supporting this movie as much, because when I first watched it, I really was like happy, but then I realized they set me up, because it was Christmas night with my family, warm and cozy for the first time in a long time because of COVID, and I'm like, of course I'm happy.
It's true. No, you.
And then, like, you like rewatch it. Just I like rewatched it because like people were like upset, and I was like,
it is kind of weird. It's like, why would they be upset? Oh, I just love technology. But yeah, you were talking about people were upset, and yeah. as soon as you said that, it froze, and it's like, why are people upset? But then it's like, oh no, wait, no, I know why people are upset, because magic, because movie magic.
Well, I think they were more upset because they expected more out of a Wonder Woman sequel, because the first Wonder Woman was so good.
Oh, yeah.
I think I was like, I wasn't expecting it to be better than the first one. So I was already like lowering my bar, and then I'm lowering the bar that I haven't seen a new movie at all this year. Lower it again. It's Wonder Woman. I don't want to have a high bar because I love her. Lowering it again. And then I'm a DC fan, and I'm hoping and wishing for the best, and a movie fan. And I want movies to be made, and I feel really bad that they're not getting made. So the bar was like as low as it could go. We'd have to get James Cameron to come down here and raise the bar again. But that's from South Park, by the way. Sorry. Still.
No, I thought there was going to be like an Avatar comment going to be in there somewhere.
James Cameron. He goes on like an adventure in the sub, like low into the deepest of the ocean to grab the bar for movies and try to pull up. And everyone's like, no one asked you to do this. And he's like, but I'm doing it. And they're like, no, like, we don't care. And he's like, it's too late. It's done. And people are like, oh, he has the best movie. And the bar is raised to a point that we don't care. Avatar movie. It was really good. I love it. But apparently it put salt in people's wounds. But yeah, I was just like, okay, my bar is as low as it can go. And it didn't hit my bar. And I was like, it's fine. And then the more I got to analyze it with my other movie comic book friends, it made me sad. And now I'm a little crotchety old woman about it.
Well, remember who's the older of the two. So thank you very much. I'm the one that's at the big 3-0. So, but yeah, I still try to keep an open mind with certain movies, unless somebody has literally given me like examples as to why this movie is probably going to make you hate it. With the Wonder Woman one, it is one of those movies where, yes, it did kind of set the pace for, hey, there is some positive light for DC. With Wonder Woman's sequel, it's kind of like, okay, at least, let's see if it at least makes it to the same bar that got set by Wonder Woman. Did it? I know we're kind of jumping ahead to this, but at this point, it doesn't matter. Honestly, I still think the first one is the better of the two, the one that I prefer. Another movie we're going to talk about, I appreciate it more because of the other movie we'll be talking about later on. But there are still some highlights in the movie that I still appreciate. I mean, I do mention the fact that I still think that even though this movie was not as good as its predecessor, Gal Gadot still kills it as Wonder Woman. She still brings like her all. She brings in her like 110% to make that character still what it is. So it's one of those things where, like, I leave the movie thinking, okay, the movie itself I don't like as much as the first one, but I still have that same high expectation with Wonder Woman because, like you said, they picked the right person to play it, and she's going to kill it no matter what. So that was one of the things where it's like, okay, at least they didn't ruin it for me. There's probably some people like, no, she's ruined for me. I'm not one of those people. It's like, nope, she's still on that same level, maybe a little bit higher because they do actually give her more emotion than what they did to her in the first one. It's like, but she did cry. Yeah, but she didn't have that that feeling of going through the process of losing again until she had to realize, you know, she had to recant her wish, which, oh, geez, let's talk about that, by the way. My God, that, I think that there just came a point where it just got really stupid with everything they did. I mean, some people might say, it's a good threat. I'm like, no, it's not. We went from facing a god to a guy who literally just says, ooh, there's a rock that can grant wishes. I want to become this rock. Hey, people, touch me and make a wish. Like, what the absolute hell is this? I'm just thinking about this right now. It's like, you are inviting so many people of different demographics, of very dark demographics, to literally be like, oh, I could do the same thing. This is the new white van pulling up. Hey, I got free candy. That is the point where it's at right now. I can't believe it took me this long to think about that, but that was literally what it was. This guy literally became the rock, and he's just like, not that rock. First of all, he became a wishing rock that literally was like, touch me and make a wish and I'll make it come true. It's like, oh gosh, I'm still watching Once Upon a Time, where literally one of the ultimate things is that magic has a price. And at least with this one, it's like, okay, they still have a price for him granting these wishes. He's literally slowly dying, but he's also trying to find a way to keep his life force going, which that took a bit of an interesting turn, but okay.
None of that was ever explained, by the way. Like, even a lot of people question, like, what's going on? Why is he, like, dying from all these wishes? And, like, we don't know. Magic.
Just magic. For me, it's like magic comes with a price. Okay. What exactly is the price that he's paying? Well, his life is, like, okay. Could you go... I know that I don't need too much details when it comes to certain parts, but that could use a little more detail for it instead of just being like, well, oh, if
you might die. When you said magic had a price, you were 100% right. That's why when you make a wish, something gets taken away. And that's you. Like, from you. If you wished for luscious locks of hair that flowed to the ground, you might lose all your other body hair. Like, who knows? Like, whatever the monkey's paw magic stuff wants to do, but why did the wishing stone take a toll?
Because it's an inanimate object. It's literally one of those things where it's like, it has no feelings, it has no heart, it's fine. It doesn't have anything with it, but it's a person, it's a different story. Sure, let's go with that.
Yeah, but, I mean, can we also just say, like, Maxwell Lord isn't like, that great of a Wonder Woman villain?
No.
Literary terms, he has faced off against the whole Justice League, and he did hold, you know, some weight, as in Wonder Woman had to kill him, but, which is a big deal for Wonder Woman, But in general, like, I don't know about you, but I, like, clicked play for the cheetah. Like, I thought maybe, you know, like, a really big, pretty popular, pretty in the league of villains villain was going to be the main baddie. And I was excited to see this cat fight take place.
You know what? Let's go into that, because this was, for me, one of the highlights of the movie, other than Gal Gadot being badass. Kristen Wiig, who a lot of people know her a lot from her comedy stuff, especially on SNL, I truly believe that she killed it in this role. She absolutely did play that, you know, dorky, kind of, you know, geeky, socially awkward character. And then she found a way to mold that character into somebody who was definitely, you know, as soon as she had a taste for power, it's like, I like it. I kind of want to keep it. She wanted to kind of keep that going. I think that one of the best ways I could describe it is like with the Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man. He definitely had that kind of deal where it definitely felt like you could feel the character just processing and becoming something new and becoming what he soon became to be, which was the fact that, hey, he's going to be, you know, the superhero. With her, again, she's more of a comedy character, but you felt like she could definitely do the serious roles. She definitely can do a lot of the serious moments. And I'm not going to lie, up, like, I would say like three quarters of the way, I was on board with it. Even when they showed her have her first fight with Wonder Woman, I was just like, okay, yeah, I'm for this. If we keep it like this, I'm totally okay with this. I am 100% fine with that. My only issue to take away from that is the CGI cheetah deal. Oh dear God, this was like watching the new live action Cats, which I have not watched, and in all honesty, I'm sorry. That is just, as soon as I saw the trailer for it, I literally had my jaw on the ground out of fear. Like, I don't like this. I don't want this in my house, thank you. And as soon as I saw that, I'm like, no, you went to that level. You dug to that bottom of the barrel kind of CGI animation where you didn't need to. You could have probably had her look so much more badass, but no, it was like, hey, we got a cheetah character. Let's just only put her face on. No, 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 just no. I would much rather her just be like having maybe like a cheetah, like pelts kind of deal, like a, oh, who's looking at that? Kraven the Hunter, there we go, from Marvel, where she would have had some kind of feeling like that. That would have been fine with. If she wanted to throw some claws in there, sure, make them look good, that's fine. But going full-fledged, oh, she's going to look like a legit cheetah, that's where I had an issue. And we just got done doing the live-action Lion King deal. That just, that was rough.
Well, okay, so just for continuity-wise, like, cheetah is a humanoid beast.
Sure.
So, like, if you think of Beauty and the Beast in there is very similar to Cheetah. Like, very, she should have fur, spots, claws, teeth, eyes, tail, not ears, really, but all of that I was down to clown around with. I'll agree. I liked Kristen Wiig. I was pretty nervous about her role, but I also will, you know, I will pay the piper and be like, yeah, like, I will go with the cheetah that you're giving me. It's not the Barbara that I thought I was going to get. Am I still?
Nope, you're good. You're good. Or it could be a situation where she
can't. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
What is going on?
Technology, we gotta love it at this point. Yeah, Kristen Wiig. About, I think you were nervous going in, but I think you had more confidence as time went on. I think it was where we left off.
Yeah, are we good?
Yeah, we're good.
Okay. Yeah, no, I will totally, I'll buy in, and I'll be like, hey, you know, DC has really made it adamant that their universes are separate. They're multiversing everything, which is a big comic book thing. So, like, the DC Cinematic Universe, the DC Cartoon Universe, the DC CW universes are all happening and all are all real and relevant, but they're going to have different things and they're going to be part of a multiverse. And so you're like, like, DC, like, Crisis really brought this all together for us. So when you give me a certain cheetah, like a certain Barbara, I will be like, okay, sure. She doesn't have to be the one that was like the badass cool cheetah. She can be like this nerdy girl who's envious for Wonder Woman's good looks and coolness, which was also interesting. But again, I'm down for it.
It might have been more of her confidence than anything, because you kind of see that the confidence from a Barbara kind of start off as kind of very low, but then as time went on, she definitely started gaining that confidence. Like, you know, yeah, I can be that person that can, you know, make a difference. I can be that person that knows this kind of stuff, to the point where her confidence is also kind of her detriment, is that it's going to probably hurt her more than anything, which in the end it definitely did.
Yeah. I mean, I could definitely, I think confidence is a good way to say it. I always correlate confidence as like a positive thing. So like, I sometimes don't want to like use that as like a envious tool that like Barbara was like, she was basically, I want to be her. So as much as I would love to just say like confidence was what she wanted, it wasn't a good statement. Like, it was a little bit of a creepy, like, all encompassing, my life is awful, her life is better, so let's just jump into that life. Which gives you a better platform, I guess, to be a villain on. But yeah, like, it was kind of cool that they were becoming friends and stuff, and then all the weird stuff.
And, the weird stuff happened, and it's like,
yeah, oh boy. It was just so random. Everything was just so, like you had to be like, sure, okay, we could go here now, because we just get this Wonder Woman who has been not living life at all, not having friends, not going out, not doing anything, and all of a sudden, like, Barbara comes, and, like, she's like, maybe I'll go out with Barbara, maybe I'll do this with Barbara, and you're like, okay, sure.
Yeah. I get your point. Yeah, I still stand with the fact that it was one of the highlights of it, but like I said, once we reached that final climax, once we reached the final deal where she became basically the Cats live action deal, that's where I was like, no, just no, damn it.
Yeah.
I think it was
bad CGI.
Yeah, well, I think there were some parts where the CGI was good, like a lot of movies, but then there's some other points where it just was rough.
That's the problem though with dark scenes, when you get dark fights. Usually in Hollywood, and I don't know about this movie, I don't know if they had any issues, but like, if they darken everything, it's to raise the quality of the CGI.
Oh, sure.
So something probably happened, or they ran out of money, something, but like, yeah, the CGI was not top notch from what you would want out of a Wonder Woman movie. And because of that, they're like, well, what if we just make everything dark so they can't see anything? You're like, whoa, that's a way to solve the problem.
Right. Let's go into the final climax that we had with Maxwell as well as Cheetah. One of the things that was like hinted throughout the movie was that the Amazons had like this great warrior that, you know, helped save, you know, everything and such like that. Obviously, there's something awesome that happened at the very end, which I'm very excited to talk about. But one thing that you kind of mentioned to me, which really had me kind of think about it, and then it's like, yeah, that does kind of seem stupid that they just hyped up this armor that they had where it was like impenetrable. It was able to, you know, handle everything and blah, blah, blah. And literally they view the final climax with Cheetah and Maxwell, and doesn't seem to really hold up that well, does it?
No. and it's great because I actually, for Christmas, somebody bought me the action figure of her with her wings and stuff. And I was really stoked about that. It was very marketable outfit. I don't know if that was why it was even talked about, because like you said, there's not much else to go along with it except for the fact that it looked cool. Because I mean, you would think that it would make sense to wear that so she could fly to get to where she needed to go because it had wings. But, you know, they kind of allowed her to fly without it.
They hinted at that, like, twice. I mean, once before the climax happened and then once again when the movie was coming to an end. It's like, okay, yeah. So she didn't really need that... They didn't need that armor anywhere.
But you know what, though? The problem is I think they forgot to also say then, like, somehow, like, she forgot how to fly for Batman versus Superman and Justice League and everything.
That is true.
It's weird how she knew how to fly, and then, like, 20 to 40 years later, she forgot how to fly.
Apparently,
but you know what? It could have been magic. Maybe somebody wished it and didn't resent or repent their wish. And they're like, "No, she can't fly anymore." And she's like, "Doesn't even know what happened."
At this point, it wouldn't really surprise me. So, comparing final climaxes from the original, where we had this big battle with Kratos, and God, it was great, to the final climax where literally it ends with Diana Prince giving a speech about sacrifice and, you know, being true to yourself and everything like that. It's like, okay, I understand that there are very few women in the movie realm that just don't stand out as, like, you know, women, you know, role models and, you know, stand out as, like, what's the phrase I'm looking for? Just, because I don't want to say that. They don't seem like they're the main focus on it. But you had that with the original, with the, you know, first movie, where she literally just did not give up. She kept fighting to the end. Hey, great. But now you're making it seem like, okay, so she can now use words to change the mind. And that's enough to cause this guy who has this unlimited power to be like, no, I don't want it anymore. It's like, okay. Even if the roles were reversed and it was a guy talking to a woman, I would even say, like, no, this is no. This is a big bucket of no. Here you go, DC. Just take it. Deal with it. I get what they were trying to do. I just did not like it.
Well, Nate, you forgot. You forgot. First, you need to buy in. And it sounds like that's what you forgot to do. So first, understand that when you watch something on TV, particles are touching you. So you're getting touched every time you turn that screen on. Okay? So first off, remember that. You obviously did not remember that. So when I announce something on the TV, I am touching you. And that is why your wishes get to come true. And even though me as a villain, Maxwell Lord, I have scorned probably, I would say by now, almost 150 people on the earth. With, you know, the oil thing and the putting the one guy in prison and the president, you know, being like, give me all your stuff. At least 150 people. But don't worry, none of them would ever wish harm upon me because that would be weird. And that could probably ruin the fact that I'm now getting all the wishes. And if somebody wished me dead, that would ruin the whole premise of the story. So don't do that. Don't even go there. And just letting everybody know, if you didn't know, the lasso can do whatever we want it to do. Like, whatever. It doesn't matter because it's magic. So if the lasso gets to talk and, like, it's a broadcast system, if you didn't know it, it is. So it is a TV broadcast system that if I talk with the lasso, whoever I want to hear it obviously gets to hear it. So here's my voice. As long as I'm lassoed to the guy touching you, you know that I'm talking. And don't forget about Alistair, because Alistair was, you know, the main guy of why. It wasn't anyone else, but it was the kid who it had a good premise like that. Oh, well, my kid loves me no matter what, even if I'm an awful person.
Even if I kill thousands of people, it's totally fine. I'm also real. I'm also realizing this is a very handsy episode that I think we've ever done since knowing each other. So much talk about touching.
Don't forget about the touching. Everyone's being touched by TV particles. That's where it all came together. If you forgot about that TV particles touch you, then you're obviously confused
right now. Oh, no, that.
Yeah, but yeah, so don't wish him away. He's touching everybody, and the lasso is a broadcasting system. So now with those three things in mind, yeah, the ending makes total sense.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man. That, honestly, you just took my point and just stretched it out beyond belief, but in the best possible way.
But yeah, but that's true. Like, it is. Everything is like, well, did you not buy into all this? Because I can tell you didn't. That's why you're so upset.
Oh my gosh, that is great.
And like, did he get arrested?
I don't think he did. I think it was literally... No, I think he literally just reunited with his kid, and he just lived off happily ever after with no consequences whatsoever. At least we're certain.
But what about cheaters never prosper? I thought that was the theme. Lost right now.
Oh my gosh, that
wasn't definitely too just long of a that. Movie. Oh wait.
That,
it was over 2 hours long.
There was so much that they could have trimmed off there. I think that they had like so many climaxes where it was like, no, you did not need that. So much fat you could have trimmed up right there. Just wow. Yeah. Last final highlight for me was the end credit scene where literally you have the Amazon's warrior they were referring to that the entire movie appear, and it's the original Wonder Woman. It's Linda Carter, to which I remember I was texting you during the end credits, like, okay, I see this movie, blah, blah, blah. And I literally said, dot, 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 Linda Carter, my God. It was literally happening. No, it was literally happening. It was literally happening within that moment where I'm just like, okay, blah, blah.
Oh, cool.
So it was like a legit reaction deal where you might think like, oh, he just did it for effects. Like, no, that legit happened where it's like, oh my God, it's Linda Carter.
It was definitely a good fan moment as a Wonder Woman fan. But then that just made me more salty about the fact that
one good moment at the end of a movie does not make up for the rest.
Right. Well, it was just like, it would have been cool. Like if they really wanted to put Linda Carter in the movie, it would have been cool to put her in the movie. Like have her be that warrior. If Wonder Woman's struggling and there's another Amazon warrior out there who had that armor, like, I would be more excited to have seen another Wonder Woman help out, or another Amazonian, sorry, help out, give her a little role. Like, all I have to say.
Is it too much to ask to have one more run with Linda Carter as anything, whether it's a Wonder Woman deal or just an Amazon deal? Is it too much to ask? I don't think it is. And I'm honestly hoping that if we do get a third Wonder Woman, maybe that is where she gets put in. Maybe she becomes kind of like a mentor to Diana Prince to really help her, you know, hone in on all of her powers. Like, obviously, there's still more for Diana Prince to, you know, learn about her, you know, learn about her past, learn about her history, learn about, you know, what she's capable of. Honestly, I actually, now thinking about it, I would actually watch that movie. If it's literally just hour and a half of literally Linda Carter teaching Wonder Woman how to be Wonder Woman, I'm okay with this. Then the rest of the half hour is just like evil doer, blah, blah, blah. It's like, you know what? I'm cool with that. I get to see Linda Carter and Gal Gadot on TV, on a big screen. They're going to make it awesome. But you only have like a half an hour of evil doer. You know, I'm okay with that, shockingly. Because I think that there are so many people like myself that would be excited for it. But overall thoughts on the movie, yeah, I think we're both in agreement that it's not as good as the first one was. It has its highlights, but there was so much stuff that I think they started just derailing from the path that they could have really gone on. Because obviously with Wonder Woman, they had a straight, narrow path. It was clear. It was great. With this one, it kind of was like one of those things where you're just on the highway and there's the point where you're kind of getting tired and you kind of go to the side of the road and you just hit that part of the highway. That's what I feel like this movie was. And then there's also a couple pit stops that were unnecessary.
Yeah. I would have to say this movie, the whole movie was unnecessary. I don't need it. I would pretend more that it didn't exist in the DC cinematic universe just because of all the problems, that arose from this movie. You gotta love that she had the invisible jet that they just knew how to fly and she did it to a coffee cup. So of course she could do it to a fighter pilot jet that a guy from World War I was able to fly. We actually, for our Twitch live stream, had a captain in the Air Force, my friend Roz, on screen, who loved the movie. She's a very positive, awesome, like, she's like, I loved the movie. And we were like, oh, we're about to break it down. Like, no, it's fine. And she was the positive light in the whole thing. That's why her themes she was like very thematic with it. But she also, she was like, okay, as a member of the Air Force, I have to say that was bullshit. She was like, one, no way they're like, even if they got to the plane, it had gas in the Smithsonian, like, and they flew it off. She's like, no way would they get through air patrol and all this. Like, there's so many, especially in Washington, D.C., so many different regulations and radar that they would, come on.
just come on. Just throw me one. Just come on. Just give me something.
No, he couldn't fly, it would be the first problem. And all the other problems are just technology-based that 1984 already did have. You know what I would have been happiest with? And I know this is an awful thing for any moviegoer, but I would have been most happy if at the end the big wish was that this never happened. And so that they had to go back to her before she got the stone and everything was gone, nothing changed. So then that would proceed to going to Batman versus Superman and giving us the same exact awkward Wonder Woman that did not know, that had been away from humanity for over 100 years. That's what she said, who couldn't fly and who had the tenacity and the warrior spirit of a warrior. She had her shield and sword. Why didn't she have her shield and sword at all? I didn't understand. Why is she rescuing people in a mall or around all of Washington, D.C. when she had not been there for 100 years? Like, you got to remember what you, like, what is this? Why don't people watch their own movies? Like, I am trying to stay within your realm of what you told me the DC universe is going to be. And so if you don't watch your own movies, how the hell am I supposed to?
I mean, you're not wrong. You're definitely not wrong about that.
It was so frustrating. All I could say.
Honestly, if they did do that ending, I probably would have bought into that too. It would have been like, oh, okay, that's actually kind of nice.
And then you would have still been mad, because that's like the Twilight last movie. Did you watch the Twilight series when they had the battle?
That's right. The Breaking Dawn part two, yeah.
Yeah, everybody dies. And you were like, wait, that didn't happen at all. And like, some people are oh, what the hell? Like, this was the only reason we wanted to watch. But other people are like, but at least no one's dead. So you'd have some happy people. And I would probably have been, well, at least it explains all the faults of the movie.
Yeah, I think I would agree with that.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Kota Jacobs, the crusader and visionary behind A Brighter Future in Wrestling. If you're an honorable and noble public servant like myself, you are listening to the Game Changer Podcast.
This is the Princess of Pro Wrestling, SoCal Val, inviting you to watch Grown Ass Women TV every Wednesday at 5 p.m. Eastern on YouTube. GotTV is the ultimate slumber party with me, Lisa Marie Varon, and Mickey James. Plus, special guests like Mick Foley, WWE's Paige, and more. We're live in the YouTube chat room every Wednesday for each episode premiere. So join us, and don't forget to bring a cocktail. Visit GotTV.com for more info. That's GAWTV.com. We'll see you there.
Welcome back to the special edition of the Game Changer Podcast, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Nate the Effing Great, being joined here by one of the former co-hosts, but also one of the best friends of the show, that being Victory Bell, a.k.a. Tori. We just got done talking about Wonder Woman. Let's go into Disney, shall we? Oh, God, just out of the snake pit and into the fire pit with spikes. It was literally
Did you let everybody know that we were going to, like, just rake over everybody's favorite stuff?
Honestly, I think that it's better when they get surprised about this. So when it comes to this movie, I just don't care. I just do not care. We're talking about the live action Mulan, ladies and gentlemen, which trailer wise seemed promising. Then we had articles of, well, there's not going to be any Mushu, there's not going to be any songs, no Donny Osmond. Like, okay, this will be interesting. I'm still kind of interested in seeing what's going on here. Then I hear nothing but review after review after review about this movie. I'm like, oh God, this is where it's going to be something that I'm not going to enjoy, is it? And then finally, when we were talking about doing the show, it's one of those things like, maybe I should just watch it just to kind of see what I'm kind of in for and what I kind of missed out on. God, could those reviews not be any more truthful? But they could have been more brutally honest about it, because my God, I remember you telling me that how you watched this movie, you were kind of like switching back and forth between this movie and I think we were also bringing up Bridgerton during that time. I think honestly, I would have much rather watched Bridgerton than this. It just...
No question. I know you were saying that you haven't watched much of it yet, but no, Bridgerton's a great show. Like, I have hardly any complaints, so I won't even compare Mulan to Bridgerton. Yep. I can't.
Yeah, no. And like I said, we may gloss on that in a future episode, but... Live action Mulan. So we already had our hesitations going in, and I mean, the only other live action Disney movie that came out before this was the live action Lady and the Tramp, I believe it was, which honestly, I think,
like, you're on Disney Plus you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Just making sure. Yeah,
so I think that when I saw Lady and the Tramp, I was like, you know, the original one was more interesting than this. I get it. They're trying to make it CGI. They're trying to make it almost like a bit-by-bit kind of deal. It just bored me a bit. It's not to the point where I, like, hated it. It was just like, it's just nothing really added on to here. Then you go into the Mulan, which honestly is probably one of their more interesting, if not a... Honestly, I think it's a huge classic that a lot of people definitely overlook and forget about the fact that literally woman saves China. Now, obviously, Disney tried to basically make it a lot more kid-friendly than what the original one was, and I think that's what they were trying to do with this one. Did they do that? Let's talk about that. So, talk about first... We talked about the first scene for Wonder Woman. Why not talk about the first scene for this movie? Apparently, this was the only thing we needed to see to know that, okay, this is going to be bullshit, isn't it? And I do not apologize for language in advance. For those of you that are going to be offended very easily by vulgar language, I do not apologize, because it's to that point where it just got that bad. She apparently was being trained, which is one thing, but the fact that she was able to be so perfect about it, like almost flawless with this training, is like, seriously? So she's literally going to be perfect with, like, very little to no flaws whatsoever, except for the fact that she doesn't have a little ding-a-ling between her legs. What? I mean, this is ultimately what it is. I'm sorry, but this is ultimately what it is.
I wasn't ready for that.
But, yeah, that just... Wow. Again, they... some of the things that I think a lot of critics definitely do hit on the fact is that certain characters, they make too perfect compared to the originals, where they have their struggles, they have their flaws, they have their
reasons. Is it a Mary Sue? Is that what they call it? A Mary Sue?
Oh, is that what it's called?
I think so. It's when, yeah, they try to, like, Mary Sue is a female character that almost has, like, no flaws that you just have to accept.
I think you're right. I think that is what they call it. So do they make this a Mary Sue? Yeah. No, they definitely do Mary Sue. They Mary Sue the shit out of this movie. I'm sorry. Yeah. But it is exactly that. And, you know, it doesn't really get better from there. I think either you said this or you said somebody, you know, I think like first 10 minutes you were already just like, nope,
yeah, not happening. I said, I think in the first 5 minutes, I think I said, I was extremely confused, didn't know where they were taking me, and was hoping to learn. And then they really mansplained it all real quick. And you're like, oh, good. I'm glad you didn't show me because this is the movie. Glad you just told me about all the hardships that are going on. But just real quick, I did want to say, like, so I'm cool with the idea behind Mulan of let's have it an all Asian cast, let's do all this stuff in the more Chinese style of movie and storytelling. Mm-hmm. I loved that. I thought that was a great idea. And they like truly, Disney was like, we're going to cater this to China because China is a money. And we're like, okay, the United States, we're like, that's cool. We had the cartoon Mulan who was too westernized for Disney's liking for the new Mulan. They're like, so, you know, that BS, that's the songs? Not allowed to westernize. And I was like, I can see you have a point. Like, they're kind of funny, and I sing them all the time. They definitely have, like, the little, like, do-do-do-do-do-do-do. That's about as Chinese as they get. But yeah, so they were really trying to cater this to China, and that's all I can say. So I didn't expect to like it as much, but then when China also said, boo, we hate it, I was like, oh. Like, the movie was declared a failure in China, so I thought that was like, oh, uh-oh.
The fact that I read articles about that where... Yeah. Where China was even just like, yeah, we don't even want this in our deal. It's like, wow, you would have to hit a new kind of low to literally have the demographic that you're aiming for basically say, no, thank you. They just took like one look at it and they're just like, you know what? I'm basically doing like the metaphorical, like take the food back. It's not to our liking kind of deal.
They just did the Heisman on that Mulan movie.
They did. And for a reason. So, okay. I try to be optimistic and I try to be positive when it comes to this. Are there any positives when it comes to this movie? The fight scenes are kind of cool. I mean, it's one of those things where, you know, they at least looks like they're legit, you know, being awesome. They're at least trying to at least incorporate something really cool into it.
The martial arts is they did good with the casting of people who could actually perform the martial arts.
Yeah, no, definitely agree with that. Some of the visuals, like the backgrounds and a lot of like the landscaping deal, those were kind of cool. Those I thought, okay, they're at least trying to make this more, you know, the kind of like, you know, the China kind of feel to it. They definitely are trying to at least, again, they're trying to appease that demographic. It's like, okay, that's one thing. So Disney does do at least a good job of trying to be at that. Anything else really? Unless you got something, I got nothing. I'm ready to tear this movie apart.
No, I would have to say... they did try to be a little more historically accurate. I forget. I haven't watched Mulan in a really long time now. I forget what they called them, but it wasn't, you know, the Huns attacking them. Yeah. It was actually a more specific. So they went with a little more specific in the area of who the enemy was. That's all I can say. Because they wanted to, they told us it was going to be more historically accurate with the Mulan poem, which is a one-page poem of the hero of China being Mulan. Not a lot to go off of, so there is a lot of dramatization that you can spark off of this one poem. And so they said they were going to be more historically accurate, and I would have to argue the fact that they went off the rails. But the name of the villain was correct, so that's positive.
Okay, so that is a positive. All right. Let me just crack my knuckles a little bit. Let's talk about how this movie definitely made things in. All right, so starting off the bat with the family itself. You have the mom, you have the dad, you have Mulan. Do you have the grandmother? No. Do you have somebody that's kind of like, no. Do you have a character that at least, you know, has some kind of purpose to it? You have a sister in there. Does she really do anything? No, she's there for like a brief cup of coffee and that's about it. She's just kind of there to make the family kind of whole. Issues we have with this. At first, the dad is like, yes, I'll train my daughter to be a, to be like a warrior, to make her, you know, tough, to make it like this and blah, blah, blah. I hope that you find somebody who's totally accepting it and blah, blah, blah. It's going to be great. Man, did that coin just flip over in a matter of like two scenes? Soon as they decide to say, hey, we're going to have the war happening and every man from the, for the family, blah, blah. You understand the story. I don't need to go into full details.
Oh, yeah.
But as soon as they talk, they'd have like the dinner scene where Mulan's basically trying to say, you know, don't do this, Papa. You're not strong enough. He literally shifts the coin, like I said, and it's like, I must do this for my family. Learn your place. Like, the fuck did this come from? You literally were having a good bonding scene at the beginning of the movie, and then you just shatter it in one single scene. What is this family hypocritical? What the actual? What is? Are you trying to be historically accurate? Because this is not. I guarantee you, this is not what any family in China is like. They are not like literally like we're gonna be super nice to when you're kids. When you're teenagers, it's just like you learn your place. No family does that shit unless they're mental. That's the way I can say it. I'm not putting it gingerly. So the family right off the bat that just pissed me off. That one scene already had me checking out. Like, are you kidding me? You literally had this moment where he just snaps and that's it. It's like, no. You have to earn that relationship between the father and the daughter, which surprisingly the original one did. He was sad about the fact of hearing that Mulan was probably not going to find a suitor. He was sad about that. He tried to be that guiding light. He tried to be that person who is going to be, you know, the shoulder that she can cry on. And had that scene where he talks about, you know, there's that one flower that's going to be a late bloomer, but it's going to be just as beautiful as the rest. You didn't have that. And it made it more crushing with the scene where he basically said, says, you know, no, don't bring your more dishonor, because you understand that he's not trying to do this to hurt her. He's doing this because he was wrapped up in the moment. And if somebody said, isn't this the same thing? No, literally came out of nowhere with very little build to this relationship.
Yeah, that's going to actually be like a common trend throughout the whole movie, is that they don't.
Oh, thanks for that reminder.
They don't tie any relationships. Like, they don't make you feel like anybody should like anybody in this movie. And that's a huge problem. Like, connection is why people exist. So if you're going to make a movie that should have a very strong family or theme bond, and you're not going to give us anything, it's going to be a problem. But that's not even my biggest issue in the first opening scenes and stuff. My biggest issue is the fact that they explain that she has superpowers.
Oh, gee, the fucking matchmaker scene. My God. So, okay, do you guys remember in the matchmaker scene where she's basically struggling with the notes on her arm? She's trying to be perfect. She has a cricket that's up her butt. I don't know. It was really weird.
Upper butt.
I, You know what I mean. You know what I mean.
It
sounds weird when I say it like that. But she literally has a quick cricket by her side. She's basically trying to balance everything out. But she's still what? She's still human. She's trying to make sure that everything was fine. But apparently in this version, oh, that sister has a fear of spiders. Ah, who doesn't? Move the fuck along. Oh, they did. By literally having a tray, like, post of all the dishes, and then somehow she's able to catch them all with her foot and her two hands, and she's able to make it look really great. She still breaks it at the end. That does not erase the fact that she literally just did this, like she's done this a million times. Just no.
They explain a little bit.
I don't care.
About what, really what her superpower that. Is that she has really high chi, which chi is, you know, like this energy flowing through your body, and it's a very, you know, of Chinese origin and stuff, and there's chi blockers and things, and it's a real thing, but they decided to, instead of make it like a real thing, what if like it was like a superpower? And everyone was like, whoa, everybody likes superheroes right now. Oh my gosh, that's a great idea. Let's make Mulan a Disney princess into a superpowered person. And everyone's like, yeah, that sounds great. And me in the corner, I'd be like, wait, but isn't this about women empowerment? Like, what if she just did it by being a normal person? Like, no, women can't do that. And I'd be like, oh, okay, sorry, forgot.
I obviously am one of those people that has that dingling between my legs. Yeah, sure, no. I obviously don't know what I'm talking about, obviously.
Right. It's just like they took away, again, you've already heard me complain multiple times about Disney live action not having the same theme. And the theme of Mulan is like women empowerment, like love, family. And it's like, you can do it. Like, she can do it. And this was like, no, no, no. Like, she still can do it. But the reason behind that she can do it is the fact that she has a superpower that she was blessed with. So she is better than everybody because of a superpower, not because of any perseverance or any determination or any love for her family to want to do this for her father. It's she is better. She is the Mary Sue. She is better.
Wow. What a bitch. Jeez. Oh my gosh. I want to preface this one thing, ladies and gentlemen, is that whenever I make comments like this, I'm focusing on the character that was presented by Disney, not the actor, anything that involves with the actors, actresses. I'm never going to be blaming it, unless there's somebody that literally has told me, oh no, this is a creative idea. It's like, oh, okay, then they're stupid. But no, yeah. This is literally one of those things where it's like, I do not hold any ill will towards the actors, the actresses. They're there doing their jobs, doing their presentations, and I'm going to appreciate them every single step of the way. But the way that they were presented, because the directors just decide, no, we gotta go this way. Just, that's where I'm gonna be pissed off at. So, gonna gloss over the fact, because they did this in this movie. That emotional scene where she's literally contemplating doing this, and then that big scene where she cuts her hair, gets the armor on, blah, blah. They literally just like, oh, well, they've seen this before. They don't need to see this again. Okay, fine. Just why the hell not at this point? We get to the army deal. Can you be any more boring when it comes down to this? I mean, I get it. You mentioned at the beginning that they try to make it less westernized. They try to make it a little more, you know, a little more appealing to the crowd, which that's one thing. But very little character development with a lot of these people.
Yep.
And some of the characters that they talk about, you mean they mention a couple like key phrases from like some of the songs where obviously, you know, they mentioned like, you know, the three army men where it's like, you know, I want somebody who'll marvel at my strength. I want somebody who's gonna have a great smile. And as soon as I heard the guy say like, I don't care what she looks like, just depends on what she cooks like, to which I'm like, I'm more offended now for Western culture.
Yeah, they didn't put in the song.
It's literally one of those things where they just like
said everything, but you won't sing it. It's like, hey,
you know what would be a good idea? Let's just take some of the things from the songs, just the words. Let's not have music in there. Let's just have that be in there. It's like,
I feel tell me if I'm wrong, I almost am for sure they had the music, but again, as a score, during the army scene, I'll Make a Man Out of You, I thought was playing kind of in the background.
It's kind of like one of those things where they're like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Where they just kind of like bring in, but then kind of trill it out to like, you know, we have to focus on this.
Because it was definitely like the drums, like.
Yeah. But I was
like, oh my God, are we about to get down to business to defeat the new bad guys that I forgot their names of?
Those dudes. Oh my God. Well, I would love to hear Johnny. Let's get down to business to beat the dudes in black. Oh my God. That would have been so much better. Donny Osmond, you're our treasure. I'm just saying that right now because this is he's the only thing right now that's keeping me positive with this movie. I will say that it's funny when they do the whole, oh, dude, you stink deal because obviously she hasn't been able to shower. So they at least play that off. I thought that was kind of funny how they just tried to, make it where she doesn't want to have anybody try to, spoon her or see that, when she's disrobing, that kind of deal. It's like, okay, there's at least a little bit of comedy involved with that. Then they finally get to like the big scene where, she's finally able to bathe. And here comes this quote unquote love interest, I guess, that comes in. They have that kind of moment where he basically just says, you don't have to, like me. You don't have to, sacrifice for me, but be sure that do your duty for the rest of the army, something like that. It's kind of one of those things like, okay, there's potential for that. I mean, is it one of my favorite scenes? No, but it does stand out at least to where he's kind of showing his sense of duty during this entire deal. So it's like, okay, there's at least that. And that love interest really doesn't go anywhere, unlike with the original where they actually they don't make it like full on blatantly obvious, but they at least, do like little hints. So that's frustrating. That is frustrating.
That is none of it didn't matter. All of that, every single, that was one of the biggest complaints, is like every single man there were interchangeable to me. Yeah. You didn't give anyone really a difference. Like, did they look a little different? Yeah. But that's about it. I wouldn't know who was who because they didn't give them any personalities. They just were like, well, remember the guys in the original? Well, they're here. And you're like, what? I don't know. And the one guy wasn't the son of the general anymore.
I think
so he didn't have any authority over Mulan.
No.
So then there wasn't that chemistry because she was going to help him be the best general that he could be because she's good at fighting. And it wasn't there. So there was really no reason, and also they didn't really do anything to make her look different. I think the whole cutting out the hair and thing was taken out because it didn't matter how long your hair was. But yeah, she didn't really look any different.
No.
And she didn't really talk any different.
She kind of had more of a raspier voice like this, so she could seem tough. I don't know why I'm trying to try to sound like a cross between Sylvester Stallone and John Travolta, but that's kind of
right.
That's kind of what I'm getting out of it.
It just doesn't what do these guys not know what a female looks like?
Barely.
I don't know. She didn't look manly to me, and I would have to complain that I don't know. I don't know what you're supposed to do in that situation, but
you're right. The other thing that, I don't know if I think I would consider this maybe another small highlight, but also one of the things I did hate about it was that there was a point where Mulan starts feeling like the acceptance of the army, not only with, you know, her peers, but also with the general himself, to the point where the general says, you know, you are a great warrior and blah, blah, blah. You have, you know, great chi, blah, 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 which the chi thing itself, I'm sorry, but I just kind of looked at what chi is kind of like, and I'm literally like, okay, so this has nothing. This is literally being based like a superpower, even yeah. though it's
like, chi is a real thing.
It is a real thing. But this fact
like, they're making in real life, and then they're pretending that it's a superpower. It's and you're stupid. Like, you're almost taking away what, like, the hair, like, for me, Eastern medicine like uses chi blocks and a lot of things that are massage based, and you're like, well, what if it was a superpower though? Yeah. And it's like, what? Like what, our blood, our life force or something? Like what? Like what are you trying to compare this to?
Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely. But he gets to the point where he says, you know, I would love for you to, you know, introduce you to my daughter, somebody who you would be, you know, who you could bring on and blah, blah, blah. And she literally is just like, yes, I would be honored. Instead of just doing what could have been the more logical plan, being like, as much as I would love to, I feel like I would not have, you know, they could have made her more humble about that instead of her just being that confident. It's like, oh yeah, no, totally. I would be a total fit for your daughter. It's like playing the part and acting like a complete twat is two different things. This was one of those things where I'm just like, no. This, if she would have said, you know, like, been like humbly, like, you know, no, that's fine, and maybe he would have persisted a little more, and she would have like said it more, and just like the, like, except, like, you know, not being disrespectful.
Maybe
to
she
him.
Already had a wife, right? Maybe she's point. Like, I already have someone at home.
No, trust me. I'm gonna touch on that a little bit later on because I have a good comparison with this. But get trying to get through this damn movie first. So, we get to like the big scene where it's, you know, the bad guy versus the army, and you know, they cut up a lot of the more emotional spots, like, you know, when they happen upon the village where the Huns just destroy everything, and then Mulan picks up the little, you know, doll where she's basically seeing like the fact that, you know, nobody is safe. Just having that moment,
innocence.
The innocence of it. Yeah, yeah. That's gone. Big scene, blah blah. They win. Okay.
Well, and Mulan wasn't a part of it for the most part. You know, she decided to go off and have a battle with the Hawk, which is a witch, and then she had
which was a pointless character, like the sister.
Yes, and like. But also you have to remember she had to take off all of her armor because obviously her armor was holding her back when she was about to go fight.
Let's talk, dive a little bit into some of like some of those side characters. Yeah, the person that plays this witch who literally is being told, you know, oh, you're going to be in a different, you know, place. Once I take over China, you're going to be accepted for who you are and blah, blah. Yeah, that never really gets fully explained. She literally could kill this dude with a single snap of her fingers, but somehow she doesn't because reasons. And then she gets killed off towards the end, and we're supposed to have this emotional connection between her and Mula. Just... yeah, no, that's never fully explained. That another pointless character that literally they're just like... female empowerment because magic, because BS. Screw off. Yeah. I know. Yeah,
it was bad.
I'm literally gonna have to put in this description now. Second half, Nate at his saltiest, because now this is where I'm gonna. We're on you with the Wonder Woman deal. You definitely showed the salty side. This is where I'm gonna be like, this is complete and utter crap. I'm almost getting to the point where it's just like, I just want to punch a wall or something like that. But not done with the movie yet because, hey, do you remember in the scene, the original? I'm going to keep doing this because it shows that the original was better. The fact that she literally has her identity basically, you know, revealed by accident. And she has that moment where she, you know, she realizes what she's done, but, you know, Shang literally spares her because of the fact that he had his life saved by her. Yeah. No, she literally comes in and is like, I realize what my, you know, honor, blah, blah, blah. You know, you can just kill me right now. And literally the captain's just like, no, I feel like you brought enough dishonor and that's going to be worse than just killing you off. It's like, okay, you're kind of the one that's being the dick right now. You're letting her prolong this deal where she's going to feel this for the rest of her life. And you're just thinking like, no, I'm just going to be a dick and let her live. It's like, wow, that's stupid. I mean, at least with the original, like I said, there's a reason why she doesn't die, because he says, you know, my debt's been paid. You saved my life. We're even. Here it's just one of those things like, no, I just don't feel like it. Like, okay, sure, that makes even more sense. And to make matters even worse, she literally shows up and they're just like, oh, well, you lied to us about being a dude. Well, come help me fight. It's like, okay, yeah, lead the army. It's like, the hell is it? Just two-sided coin BS again? Seriously?
They don't care. They do not care about the storytelling at all in this film. Like, just follow it.
It's like the kids are going to know. It's fine. Yeah, there's a reason why Lion King did so well, whereas Mulan is not. Because it was literally copy and paste, except with no emotion, which honestly says so much more about this generation than anything.
That's so sad. Yeah, that's another point. But we're not even going at that.
So, big climax. There's this moment where it was almost like, you mentioned this a week ago when we talked about doing the show, and I felt like this was the moment where it happened again. During this movie, we have like this phoenix bird that's supposed to be like the guardian of Mulan. Totally pointless. Nobody really gave a shit about that, much less me. See, somehow, like, this bird appears from behind, and there's like this symbolic moment where she's facing off the head leader, and you know, the phoenix is in the background, much like with the Jasmine deal in Aladdin, where she literally thinks in her mind that, oh, I can win this battle, and then it goes back to reality where she would have probably been dead at that point, but she comes back and then has that big monologue and blah blah blah. Just having that moment where Mulan has like the phoenix wings behind her, it's like, oh yep, shit's about to get real. It's like, oh, you just F off at this point. You've already done so much to piss me off with this movie. This was just one of the final nails in the coffin.
Yeah.
And, oh, that the way that the villain dies is that he falls down off of, like, maybe like a two-story, feels like a story, two-story kind of deal. He basically has the arrow, boo, and it looks like it's going to hit the Emperor, but through the power of chi, Mulan's able to kick it back, and it basically kills the dude. It's like, wow, somehow the fireworks thing looks a lot better at this point. Yes, it was cheesy, it was hokey, but the guy definitely did not die with honor. He died with the fact of somehow this woman, who is a one-of-a-kind woman that has a superpower that can kick arrows, and he's just like, I can catch it. Oh, shit, I missed.
Yeah, he caught another arrow. He caught a few other ones.
That's what I'm saying. It's that the one luck. Time he missed. One time he misses.
Bad luck for him. I also just, I mean, you put on, like, there was nothing more to say except that she did attempt to save Jet Li, the Emperor. We didn't even talk about how Jet Li was the Emperor, but, like, that was a huge point that I told Nate, that it blew my mind, the disrespect they gave to Jet Li with the dubbing over his voice. That to me is just disgusting. Like, why are you casting someone just to not have them talk? Like, that's disgusting. I hated everything about that. And then the Emperor, I guess, had a lot of chi too, enough chi to like move like cloth. And instead of fighting with weapons, he fought with cloth.
Because fuck the logic of everything.
Which was definitely worth watching. If you love Jet Li fighting, watching his cloth battle was... Like, why did you cast him at all? Like, let him fight like a badass. Like, we know, like, who cares if he's old? I don't give a crap. He knows he can still fight. He can still do some really cool things. So thanks for giving me Jet Li and then taking away everything I like about Jet Li. So that was worth it.
Yeah, it's kind of one of those things where it's like, wow, Tomb of the Dragon Emperor doesn't seem like a bad movie now, because of, there's some people that are going to get that reference, but
yeah,
but yeah, it is one of those things where it's like, so you have Jet Li there, but it's not like Jet Li. You could have probably just found like a body double and just CGI.
Or why not
Jet
just
Li's.
Cast someone else? Cast an old emperor gentleman then.
Yeah.
Cast the character that you need. It doesn't make any sense to have somebody you're going to dub over and then not use the skills that apply to that actor. So yeah, don't make any sense. Nothing makes any sense. And then, you know, the end is just like, it's like, okay, I guess I'm going to go home now. I've got my honor. And then, like, before she left, it's like, Mulan, wait, hey. She's like, oh, hey, guy that I fought with at points, which one are you? Oh, right, I think it's the one that I somehow had feelings for. And then he's like, by the way, like, I think he said something like, if you ever want to get together sometime. And she was like, okay, maybe, bye. And then they were like, okay, bye. We live in totally different parts of China, so it's totally fine. You know, proximity is not a thing in ancient Chinese times. But yeah, then she goes home, and then it's just kind of over.
Yeah. I mean, the most blasphemous thing that they did was they took every single bit of the emotion at the end. Because we're at the end where Mulan is still feeling like she's dishonored her family. She's coming to her father, literally totally submissive, which is honestly something that any child would do with their parents. I'm speaking from experience. Literally, she come in, she says, you know, I have this to offer, you know, as like my way of apologizing. Basically her saying that, you know, these are gifts to honor the family. And literally, the dad drops the stuff and hugs her, basically saying, I don't give a shit about that. And that, you know, line of, you know, the greatest gift and honor is having you for a daughter. That line of just showing the emotion again, the rekindling of the connection.
Yeah, that makes you, like, tear up.
Every single time. I just watched that scene alone. I don't need to watch the rest of the movie. I just need to watch that scene. I'm already, like, an emotional wreck. Because it's like, it's good. It shows that the relationship between father and daughter. It is natural, whereas this one, she feels like, oh no, I've you know, lost your armor, I've lost your sword, and blah blah blah. And he's just like, I don't care about that. No, you're the only thing that matters. Totally emotionless. And then at the end, she gets like her own sword that's like crafted, and because reasons. And then the movie just ends, and all I think to myself is, wow. Again, we appreciate the early renaissance of Disney movies, and just I think to myself, I'm offended for people in the Western Hemisphere. I'm offended for people in the Eastern Hemisphere. It's literally one of those things where I think that Doug Walker, Nostalgia Critic, said it best. Dishonor on you, dishonor on your cash cow, dishonor on every single thing that you possibly could have. It just, oh, just, that just ticked me. This was one of those movies where I had every right to avoid it, but it's not until I experience what it's like firsthand to at least see why people are mad. And not only do I see reason why I'm mad, I feel like I have more reason to be mad, because it's like, okay, I'm one of those Disney guys who likes the songs, I like the classics, like the stuff like that. I'm open to the idea of having that new take on it, just having it more story based than anything. Okay, it's under 2 hours. That's fine. I mean, as long as they don't, first five minutes, Mary Sue it. Great. Great. So I'm guessing for the next hour 55, it's going to be kind of like the same thing. Do we at least get some kind of deal where they show emotion? Oh, the first 10 minutes they show emotion, where there's a funny joke where she literally has like the makeup on, where she's doesn't change her face. She's like, look, I'm confused. I'm sad. I'm angry. Now I'm happy. And they have the little moment of happiness. Like, wow, the one bit of emotion they actually have in this movie is just right there. And then maybe a couple minutes later, hey, maybe they'll show another emotion. No, not quite. Another 10 minutes later, oh, another bit of emotion. Holy cow, that's amazing. 30 minutes later, another bit of emotion. Wow, movie ends. you literally have like four bits of emotion throughout this entire movie. That is sad. And the fact that, yeah, again, you had one movie that had literally no emotion, Lion King, be quote unquote the most highest grossing Disney movie that they had, to a live action Mulan where they barely showed emotion, and it doesn't do anything. What does this say? Our country is soulless, apparently.
I feel like how many movies have they remade now? I've had to be about 6 or 7. Maybe stop.
There's been more.
Just stop. I can't handle them remaking these movies. Like, I loved the idea of remaking the movies because with the new technology of CGI and everything, you can do some really cool things with movies that were really more presented towards a kid audience with the hour and a half limitation of what a VHS tape had. So you could go into these movies and really bring up the true stories behind them and make them a little more adult based, but also kid appropriate. Which a lot of Pixar movies do amazing, by the way. Like, hey, let's have a kid theme or a kid idea with some really adult themes underneath. And you're like, holy crap, like Frozen 2? Makes me shiver sometimes, like thinking about all the different adult themes. I was like, dude, this is not allowed in kid movies. Like, get this out of here. But yeah, I just stop. Stop making these awful, awful movies. Like, they're just that awful. Disney, your stock is going down, down, down. Nobody likes your remakes. Stop.
Yeah. Honestly, if I had to change bits about this movie, including everything about this, definitely would be more of like, you know, have her have the, you know, the journey of becoming, you know, that warrior. Maybe you can still incorporate that whole deal at the beginning where she's becoming a warrior, but have her struggle with that because she's not the perfect Mary Sue. Would I probably change anything about some of the characters? Maybe have the sister have a little more involvement with the deal. Maybe it's a situation where, you know, as soon as Mulan's leaving, maybe the sister basically is begging her not to go and have that kind of emotional connection between the two of them. But in the end, she realizes, you know, why she's doing it. And it's like, you know, just be sure to, you know, just come back alive. Maybe build up some more relationship with some of those army people. Maybe build up some more deal. Maybe give more of a reason for the Hawk girl, which to have more reason to be there than to just be, oh, we're going to make sure that when we rule China, you're treated like the person you deserve. Maybe have a deal where maybe the guys have had her family captive. I think that'd be kind of a crazy idea. It sounds crazy enough to be actually brilliant or something like that, where maybe they know her weakness or something like that. Something along those lines. Build up more to that and maybe build up more emotional deals to it. That's just me. What do I know? I'm just a guy who has a podcast who's working with a woman who knows a lot about movies as much as I do, and at least knows, hey, there should really be these finer keys that should be focused on. Because we're not just, you know, staring black and white, like, oh, this should have the music, this should have the score. No, it can have the same feel without it. That is what, you know, Pete's Dragon delivered. It was a movie that was completely different from the original. I was not a fan of it, but I understand why people enjoyed it. It's because of the fact that they focused on the story more. They focused on developing the characters more. They did that. With these movies now, it's just literally like, you know what? We're making this so that way the parents can have something they can just take their kids to see, and they'll probably spend a quick buck on it. Yeah, we're just dropping the kids off because we don't want to see this crap.
Yeah, it's super sad. I don't really understand why you would spend so much money recreating these things. And you know, you can kind of tell they don't spend too much, because a lot of it, like, even like when I think of like the Beauty and the Beast and I think of the Mulan, I feel like almost all of these like settings look really similar. Like, this town is only a circle in this area, and then in Mulan, again, it's only a circle within this area. And I don't know, I couldn't maybe that's historically correct for French and Chinese past villages, but like, I almost felt like they're just so lazy that they're going to CGI everything that they can and then make the sets as small as possible so that they can just work around that. And it I don't know, it just doesn't give me a full feel of what this world is and what we're doing here. And everything is just half-assed. The character connection, the writing, everything is. So, and I liked Beauty and the Beast, but I would let you know right now, I would trade in all of these movies to just, like, keep what the originals were, keep the magic of Disney as this animated beauty. You know what I mean? Like, it's just not worth, like, people, like, getting their hopes up, I feel, and then, like, getting let down. And I would rather have my kids eventually watch these, the good animated films that are made for kids that are friendly and have really beautiful themes of caring, of family, of acceptance, of you can do it. Like, it's just beautiful. So it just stinks that they're trying to cater to all these different things that don't really matter to the viewer in the long run.
Yeah. And one of the points I was going to make earlier is that, again, I keep bringing this show up and I really love it because of the fact that it does give me that different perspective, is Once Upon a Time, where they actually did introduce Mulan like later on in the season. They still at least trying to humanize her a little bit there. They don't really go too deep into what her backstory is kind of like. I think it's kind of one of those things where they just assume that, you know, the story of Mulan, here she is. But they at least try to bring her, you know, again, emotion. They're trying to bring her into something different. They make her, you know, basically a member of the LGBT community, which in all honesty, maybe that's something that happened. It's something where it's like, okay, I can at least, you know, give it a shot and see what happens. And you feel that kind of struggle where she wants to confess her true love for, you know, somebody, where like there was going to be a story between her and Aurora, but there just comes a moment where her heart is just broken and she literally, you feel that. It's just one of those things where it's like, okay, I can get behind this Mulan because I feel her struggle. I feel that she's not perfect, but at the same time, she's relatable to where anybody and everybody can feel that heartbreak. They can feel that kind of deal. And is it one of those things where she turns out to be like a woman that just, you know, fantasizes about every single woman? No. She knows what she wants, you know, in a person, and that's what she's kind of going for. And she's also being somebody who is being a positive role model, where she's trying to help make sure that other people don't feel that same pain of heartbreak that she did. It's one of those things like, this is a better character. Literally see her for maybe like a few episodes in these seasons, but I can connect more with that Mulan and the animated Mulan than the Mulan that we got here, where she's, oh, Mary Sue, she can do flips, she can catch cups, she can do this. She has like one flaw every, like 1 minute of every day. No, you don't make that kind of character real. Because then apparently everybody's going to be like, oh, man, I wish I could do that. I wish I could do that. And then we have more Dude Perfect videos. But that's beside the point. It's just one of those things where it's like the more you create these, you know, Mary Sue's, or I don't know what the guy version of it is for a Mary Sue. Do you have an idea of what that could be?
I don't know what the guy version is. I don't know if they really do that to the male characters.
Okay, that's fair.
It's just interesting. And I mean, like, it just makes it very not successful if you do. They kind of, you could call it like the Superman effect if you'd like, but like Superman does have faults, and they can humanize him. And when he's the best Superman he can be, he's definitely always humanized in a way. But you could say it's the Superman effect of just not making these characters relatable at all and just saying they are badass because they're badass, accept them. And you're like, it's funny how that's what people's problem with Superman is sometimes. They're like, well, he has no faults. He has nothing like this. Like, why would I like him? I like Batman better because Batman has this like humanizing past and everything. And yeah, connection means a lot. The more you see it not happening in movies, the more you don't like the movie. Like, if you can't feel any emotional human connection of why you want to like this character, you're not going to like the character, and you don't care about him. And you don't care about the movie, you don't want to talk about it. And that's why most people, like, don't even know Mulan is free on Disney Plus right now and stuff like that, because nobody cares. And it's sad, because it could have been a good movie.
Yeah. No, I definitely agree with that. I think that really hits the nail on the head. So, with that being said, this has been a special edition of the Game Changer Podcast. Now, before we go, I just want to say thank you to Tori for being a part of this. I know it's been a long time coming since we've done a podcast like this. And the fact that we got to have fun with not one but two movies on here, that's definitely telling. And I think that it's going a little bit longer than what we normally have done. But there's a lot to say about these two movies, so I think that's what makes this episode absolutely amazing. So thank you so much for your time. Now, I know that you've mentioned that you have been pretty busy on the Twitch, so why don't we kind of get a little more into that and also do some shameless plugs for you guys, because I know the Bells of Fury have been pretty busy despite it being this whole pandemic deal. So why don't we talk about that right now?
Yeah, sure. Well, thanks for having me. I always have a fun time speaking on movies that I feel I can talk about, that I've had enough expertise to talk about. But yeah, we're Rob is now live streaming on Twitch, usually weekly, and I will jump on for like a booze Tuesday. So we like play like Mario Kart and drink some margaritas and attempt to do something on the Switch. So Twitch Switch Tuesdays. That's going to be at official Rob Fury Twitch. Or / Twitch TV or whatever. I don't know how to promote it as well as he does, but yes, it's at official Rob Fury. If you find him, it's always official Rob Fury. And then we do the at Bells of Fury on our Instagram, where we announce everything. And he is at official Rob Fury on Instagram. I'm at Tori Clark _ Boss Mode. And my Boss Mode podcast is going to be coming back for season 2 in February. Once everything settles down, with my co-host and myself, which we talk about mindful practices and kind of human connection and what's important about it and how to get it. And that also can help in my acting and everything else, because as you can see, without human connection, you cannot have likable characters and you cannot have good movies.
you took my thunder. I was just about to say that is awesome.
Sorry.
No, that's great. I'm glad that one of us said that, and the fact that it came out of you had made more sense. So definitely check that out, ladies and gentlemen. You can always follow me on Twitter at RealFNGame. I'm also on the Instagram, and you can check me out on so many different podcasting formats. You can also check me out at a lot of the independent shows that are coming up here on in here in Wisconsin. Definitely check out Notebook Entertainment, as I will be working with them in the future, as well as the wrestling show, where I've been doing a lot of wrestling matches for that. Recently, they're just about to post one of my matches up that I did not too long ago. It is definitely going to be one that's going to have a bit of a nice surprise twist towards the end of it, but I can't really reveal too much of that because it's just going to be an episode you're not going to want to miss at all. So, guys, thank you so much for listening in. Thank you, Tori, for being a part of this. And we'll see you guys next time. Be safe. Be smart. Remember that you can make a difference one day at a time by being a game changer. Have a good one, guys. See ya.
Bye.
My dear prince and princess, your offer is meaningless. Don't give a damn about your rank. The gold in your sack, well, it isn't worth jack. I should make you fools go up the plank. Your riches would fill other pirates with glee, but none of those pirates are me.
They're not me.
Sing a yo-ho, keep your jewels divine. Yo-ho, and your manners refined. Cause even more precious than rum in a stein is revenge, 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 and it's gonna be mine. Revenge, revenge, revenge is gonna be mine.
Revenge? On whom?
Wait for the second verse, love.
I've savaged and pillaged and pilfered each village. My conquests I'm justly proud of.
He's proud of.
Each town that I plunder, I leave torn asunder. A pirate's life is one to love.
Lots of love.
And yet my heart's hardened as hard as a rock. Won't rest till I've skinned me a croc.
Gonna skin me a croc.
Sing yo-ho, you can beg, bleed and whine. But yo-ho, you are wasting your time. That croc of my hand, wanna tear out a spine. Revenge, revenge, revenge is
for taking your hand?
Afraid he did more than that.
Once I sailed toward a horizon where I might find happiness waiting, until that croc destroyed my life and filled me with hate unabating. Some say let it go, but I say hell no, I'm finally on the right path. Soon the dark one will feel the fire of this pirate's wrath.
Wait, did you say the Dark One?
I think we know why you haven't been able to find him. We have him in our dungeon.
Bloody hell.
Captain, give us safe passage to the Queen's castle, and you've got yourself a crocodile.
I love it. It's a deal. Have one last drink, mates. Then we've got a date with destiny. Yo ho, I'll slaughter the swine. Yo ho, must be fate's design. At last our tales will again intertwine. Revenge, revenge, revenge is gonna be mine.